Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started while he's finishing setting up. My name is David Hancock. This is the United Tea Party of Georgia. If you're in something else looking for you, stay here. We invite you to stay. We've got two speakers tonight, so we're going to go ahead and get started. We need to be out of here at 8:15-ish because they plan to leave us. We're going to start. We start with a prayer and then a pledge. So, if you wouldn't, are you in the mood to do it? Our resident reverend, Pastor Bean, will open us in a word of prayer.
Father, we thank you for those who have taken time from their busy schedule to be here tonight to hear the speakers that Dave has lined up. We thank you for the opportunity of being a part of a Tea Party, a small voice within the Republican Party as a general rule. And we pray, Lord, for each and every person that comes out. We pray for our ears to be open and our hearts and our minds to be receptive to what we are wanting to hear. And it's in the precious name of Jesus I thank you for this group.
Amen. We actually have a veteran here. Would you mind leading us in the pledge? Sure.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, last minute adjustments here. Any sarts? This is Alex. Is it Gimenez?
Gimenez.
Sorry. He's in the country here now. His parents are from, Cuba and Argentine refugees.
My mother is from Cuba, my father's from
Argentina. Wow, fled Cuba in 1961. I read a lot of fascinating stuff about him. He came to one of our last meetings and he's got a lot of information. And I'm looking forward to hear what he's going to say while we're waiting for him to get his.
Yes.
Is stuff going?
Constitution.
We have a constitution. Oh, we have a raffle. Can we do that really quickly? We have tonight's books. We're going to do Flag Day tonight. We've got two American flags and a Gadsden flag. So you got it. Should have got a little ticket when you came in. Everybody got the little ticket. Trilby in the back. Why don't we let somebody select other than me? Here you go.
844.
Last number is 844.
There you go. One of these American flags over here on the counter. We have two American flags and one Gadsden flag. So the next one's for another American flag.
853. 853.
Yay! This is great.
And now for the Gadsden flag. This is a 3x5 foot Gadsden flag, the don't tread on me flag, the one you see portrayed in various places.
353-850.
850. There you go. I bought a number of those after the recent flag flaps we had. I didn't know how long you'd be able to buy those. Would you mind really quickly come in and tell us about your bill?
Sure.
Because we have a moment.
I just wanted to come by and let everybody know that the Student Protection Act is still alive, still working its way through the legislature. We are right now in the House Rules Committee. We have 4 days left to get it through the rest of the House and to the governor's desk. So tomorrow it should be heard by the House Rules Committee. It's Senate Bill 355, and it does protect students from the crazy testing that's going on. It's changed a little bit through the process, as most of them do, but it's been amazing experience. And I want to tell you that if a mom and a teacher and a senator can sit down and write a bill and make it this far through the legislature, anybody can do it. We surprised so many people with this bill. We had no lobbyists. We weren't greasing any palms, and we're almost there. So we're really excited about it. So keep your ears open for Senate Bill 355. And please, yeah, if you feel like calling the House Rules Committee, the chairman or the co-chair, that would be wonderful, and let them know that you want to see Senate Bill 355 get passed. So, thanks.
This makes me excited. I wonder sometimes, you know, why is it we do all this work? But she's just a normal, person who decided there's a problem, there's an issue that she was passionate about, and she even, you know, sure, she called her House member, she called her Senate member. She did much more than that. She went all the steps up to the point of drafting legislation and getting it introduced. So give her a hand. Yay! Probably not as sane as she was.
30 seconds.
We've got, you may wonder, some bills didn't make it past crossover day, which was a couple of weeks ago. Some of them don't need to, like the resolutions, they don't have to. A lot of the bills that we were following did not make it. Some of the ones we were following that were bad didn't make it. Some of the ones we were following that I thought were pretty good didn't make it. So that's just kind of the way it works. Hopefully, in about an hour from now, our state senator for this area will come up, Michael Williams, will be here, and he'll give us an update on what's going on and what went on in the Capitol. Probably any announcements we have? Anything? Nydia. Every time Nydia is here videotaping, she gives these booklets. Take one if you're interested in reading it. This is an example, an explanation of the Sunshine Laws, and it's really well written. She didn't write it. This was done by Sam Olin, so it's a guy who should know what he's talking about. So if you want to come by and say hey to her and thank her for being here and videotaping it, when she's at one of our meetings and videotapes it, it ends up on online, and we can put a link to it later on. So without further ado, ready? You want a microphone, or you want to do it without it?
Actually, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Everybody's fine without a microphone? I think I can speak without a microphone. Thank you very much. Put my gun on for a second. Thank you all for coming tonight to hear a presentation about Cuba. It's not often times that I come up this far in northern part of Georgia to do a presentation on Cuba. Usually it's around Atlanta, so it's actually, thank you all for coming out for this. And I certainly enjoyed the drive. I came up for Tucker, so it was a bit of a haul. Incidentally, 400 is useless.
Yeah,
all the way out here. Thought I'd throw that in, and I think you all knew that. So let me introduce myself. My name is Alex Jimenez. I am not here in this capacity, but not only am I somebody who is the son of Cuban immigrants and Argentinian immigrants, they came over here in 1961. I was born here in the United States. Let me just clear that up in the front. I'm an American citizen. I was born here in the United States in 1962. But I also like to point out that I'm also the third vice chair of the CAB GOP. Please don't hold that against me. I'm with the CAB GOP. So I am somebody who's in the Republican Party, and I've been in the Republican Party since I was 18 years old when I cast my first vote for Ronald Reagan. I canvassed for him in 1983, and I also voted for him again in 1984. So I'm a dyed-in-the-wool Republican. And I'd like to point out that typically, Cuban Americans, at least during my generation, all of us were very conservative Republicans. So the entire exiled Cuban community, you may have guessed, because of the anti-communism, because of the Cold War, were staunch Reaganites. We didn't like socialism, we didn't like communism, we loved the United States. Simply because they opened their arms to us when no other country would take us, because the communist revolution took over my parents' country in 1959. And so that's kind of the backdrop. And the reason I'm sharing the story tonight is because so much of what's going on in Cuba isn't being reported, and whatever is being reported isn't being reported accurately. As we know, surprise, surprise, we have a liberal media. We have a left-of-center media, if not sometimes outright socialist or outright communist. And so they're not in a big hurry to expose one of their heroes. And who is their hero? Their hero is Fidel Castro. Their hero is Raul Castro. Their hero, and what they look up to is what they believe are the accomplishments of the Cuban Revolution. They also look up to the guy in the t-shirt. What's that guy that everybody wears on a t-shirt? Che Guevara. So Che Guevara is another icon. I hope to tear that icon down tonight before I'm done in 20 minutes. I believe about 20 minutes?
Sure.
20, 30?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I hope to tear those icons down with some facts, along with Raul and along with Fidel. So without any further ado, tonight's presentation is called Cuba's Plantation Economy. And by the time I'm done, I'm going to prove to you that it's not the external embargo that is what we should have been focusing on. The external embargo actually worked out beautifully for Cuba, because they were actually able to trade with every other nation on earth, except the United States. Dean Rusk, giving a speech for the Organization of American States, specifically said that the embargo's purpose was to contain Cuba and Russia's, or Moscow's, support of international terrorism. Some of you may remember that far back, that the original speech was to contain communism, to contain the Soviet Union, to contain Cuba and the Western Hemisphere. It wasn't for regime change, it wasn't for any of those other reasons, but to control international terrorism, which Cuba has outdone itself with. And so Cuba's plantation economy, the reason it's called that is because there's an internal embargo. And I'm going to show you what that internal embargo looks like and what it sounds like, because I'm going to be reading some documents. The internal embargo basically excludes Cuba from the economy. It is a company town. How many of you have heard of company towns from the 19th century, where if you worked in a mining town, you worked in the coal fields, you worked in certain industries through the late 19th century, you were paid in scrip, you weren't paid in hard currency, and you had to buy everything in what? The company store. So I'm going to show you that Cuba runs like a company town, which is not good for any of the Cubans. So before I get started, let me just show you, these are the popular images that you're accustomed with Cuba. Most of you understand Cuba from the perspective of Ricky Ricardo, right? Lucy, I'm home. So a lot of people's understanding of Cuba was limited to their experience with Lila Lucy. Of course, we know what movie this is, Scarface. And so we have an understanding of Cuba. Some people's knowledge of Cuba extends only to the movie Scarface, which is really scary. And here we have a scene from what movie? The Godfather. Some people believe, or their only understanding, is that Cuba was a haven for organized crime. And that's their own entire understanding of Cuba. Their only other understanding of Cuba is white sandy beaches and Cuban cigars. And that's about as far as it gets. It doesn't go any further than what we see the images of in the popular culture. What I'd like to kick off is just a discussion. I'll be happy to read from some documents. It's just a discussion. I'm going to leave these images up, because the discussion starts like this. I'm going to go point by point on some of the things that you don't know about Cuba and don't know about the typical Cuban citizen living under the Castros. First of all, if you go to Cuba and you go to one of these white sandy beaches, your belief is that whoever is serving you a drink, a cold drink on that sandy beach, that the money that they're being paid is actually going to reach their pockets. Now, what I'd like to point out is in 1959, there was a decree, and that decree abolished all of the labor unions in Cuba, all of them. And what they gave up was the 40-hour work week. They gave up paid vacation. They gave up maternity leave. They gave up the 40-hour work week. They gave up collective bargaining. They gave up everything. Actually, they were forced to give it up because the person who was in charge of all the unions basically betrayed them to the Castro regime. And what the Castro regime did is replaced it with one central union, one employment agency. So let me walk you through this. If you go to Cuba and someone's serving you on a beach a drink, that person is not allowed to contract, to form an employment contract with the hotel you happen to be staying at. And the reason for that is whoever that is has to get approval from the local party, the Communist Party in Cuba. Imagine if you wanted to get a job and you had to go to the local Republican or Democratic Party, and they have to give you a letter of good standing. The state party has to vouch for you, and only then will you be allowed to approach the employment agency and ask to work in a hotel. But it gets better than that. A Cuban citizen who wants to work in a hotel is basically sold by the one employment agency run by the Castros to the foreign regime, to the foreign company. Not regime, foreign company. The foreign company will typically pay anywhere from $500 to $1,000 a month for that employee. And the first thing I'd like to show you is something that the Brookings Institution, they actually did a study. The Brookings Institution, in a paper called The New Cuban Economy, wrote Roles for Foreign Investment, Latin America Initiative at Brookings. Let me describe what they found. It's the world's heaviest tax on labor. The most unusual characteristic of the Cuban foreign direct investment regime is that the labor contract system. Foreign direct investment firms are not generally allowed to directly hire labor. Rather, a state employment agency, the only one the Castros run, a typical dependency of the relevant sectoral ministry, hires, fires, settles labor disputes, establishes wage scales, and pays the wages directly to the workers. The payments are paid to the state employment agency, which in turn pays the worker. So the worker that's actually taking care of you on the beach never sees the dollars, never sees the euros. It goes to the employment agency run by the Castros. You say, well, what do they pay the workers in? They get paid in non-convertible Cuban scrip money, about 20 pesos worth. Let's walk through that again. $500 is what they sold it to the foreign concern for, that individual worker, or 500 euros. That worker never sees the money. So the first myth is that opening tourism to Cuba is going to help Cubans. It is a lie. They will never see a dollar that you put in the pocket of that hotel for any of the bills, any of the credit card transactions, any of the cash transactions. It does not go to that worker. It goes to the Castros. The Castros pocket the cash and give that worker 20 pesos of Cuban scrip. And guess what they're invited to shop at with those 20 pesos of Cuban scrip? They're invited to shop at the Castro company stores. They're not called Castro company stores. But what you're confronted with is scarcity, staleness, and rotten food, and not much of it, and very little to wear. Which is why when you see real photographs of Cuba, you see people that don't look real healthy, and they're not very well dressed, is because they live as chattel property of the state, and they never make a dime off of all their labors. So that's the first thing I'd like to clear up. Just so you know, some of you who are technically inclined, it's a 90% reduction. It is a 24-to-1 conversion ratio, so 500 pesos. 500 euros, $500 becomes 20 pesos. And one Cuban worker remarked to the author of the study for the Brookings Institution, in Cuba, it's a great myth that we live off the state. In fact, the state lives off of us. So there's the first myth that I'd like to explode, is that if you should travel to Cuba, which I hope you do not, the workers do not benefit. The second issue has to do with property.
Okay, we need to move the rock out so the door.
So the question I have, so the observation I have, close this door. The second myth that I'd like to explode is, well, at least the typical Cuban lives in a home or an apartment complex or a tenement building. Well, let me just point out something about all the buildings on the surface of the land in Cuba. My parents fled in, I believe it was March 1961. It took them about a month to get here. They had to stop in Panama. They arrived in Miami, and it's kind of an anniversary for us. We arrived April 28th, 1961. I was born in August 1962. Now, those dates are very significant. April of 1961, Castro had not yet signed a decree confiscating all property. So my parents are in Miami. I'm not born yet. They're there with my brothers. They've lost everything. They've taken everything from them. They've had to leave everything behind, their home, and I'll show you what their home was like. My parents had a beautiful home on what's called Embassy Row. My parents were upper middle class, they were politically well connected, they were professionals, and they lived on the equivalent of Rodeo Drive, or Ocean Drive in Miami, the equivalent street in Cuba. It's a beautiful home, and their place of business was only a few blocks away. They used to walk to it. And there was a park nearby, and I'm going to be passing out family photos. When I'm mentioning some of them, if you happen to be holding one of these photographs, I'll tell you what you're looking at. You're going to see my family photos. They are originals, So if you see, if you're passing it around, please be very gentle. They are family heirlooms. I would be happy to pass those out. So anyway, the second has to do with property. First, we're talking about labor and payments. The second one is property. Does anybody own any property? Well, this is the law of the Castro decree that took all my parents' money and property and that of every other Cuban. Council of Ministers, Law 989, 1961, by Osvaldo Dorcatos Torado, President of the Republic of Cuba, a figurehead, Castro was behind it. This is the declaration. Being known, the Council of Ministers agreed to sanction the following. Whereas it is clear that some persons belonging to classes affected by the measures taken by the revolution, who possess an unforgivable disdain for the motherland, have left the country. Disdain. 24 hours a day executions, thuggery, shooting police officers, shooting people in the streets, rounding people up and jailing them randomly, terrorizing every city in Cuba. You have a disdain if you leave Cuba. Whereas the majority of these persons own various goods that should be made available to the people, since which regulates departures and returns to and from national territory, also regulates the use of abandoned property. How convenient. They manage the entry and exit and the property of the island. Therefore, in exercise of the powers that have been conferred, the Council of Ministers resolves and dictates the following. Article 1. It is the authority of the Ministry of the Interior to grant exit and return permits of persons within the national territory. If the return does not take place, then who's in a hurry to come back? Anybody? If the return does not take place within the period for which it has been authorized at departure, it is considered that the person has abandoned the country. Let me put this in perspective. The reason you're fleeing is because family members and friends have been executed. They've been either shot in the street or shot in the companion prison fortress run by Che Guevara himself. And if you're a Catholic, I suggest you get a book called, that's written by Father Javier Arzuaga. He is someone who wrote a book called Before Midnight. And he was the priest who gave the last rites at the Cumming prison fortress where everyone was being executed by Che. And so he actually broke the silence in 1985 and tells the world in the book what a bloody murderer Che was. To give you an idea of what a bloody murderer he was, put this in context and why you're not coming back. Is that Javier Arzuaga gives testimony in his book, again, he is a Catholic priest who gave last rites to everyone executed, said that Che's favorite thing to do, people who were being scheduled for execution had their families visit them. Of course, they wanted to see them before they were executed. Che would walk families by the wall where everyone was being executed, covered in blood, skin, brain matter, stuff all over the ground. Che would walk families by that wall, that blood-soaked wall, to terrorize them. This is the Che Guevara that's on their shirts, by the way. So nobody's in a hurry to come back when news of that horrible scene percolates to the island. That Che not only enjoys killing his enemies of the revolution, but does so in a very grotesque, in a very cruel way, in a very torturous way. So if the return does not take place from the period for which has been authorized at departure, it is considered that the person has abandoned the country. Article 2, in cases of persons understood to be those in the second paragraph of the article, this is what they take from you. All real estate, any other kinds of rights or shares, securities of any kind, shall be construed as nationalized for confiscation in favor of the Cuban state, which are assigned to the relevant agencies. So if you leave, they open your bank account, they go into your equivalent trading account, they take everything, they take your stocks, they take your bonds, they confiscate it all and take it. And this is probably the most horrible one of all. Article 4, they will take motorized vehicles, whatever their class, which was referred to in the prior article above, and they will be occupied by the Interior Ministry, I love the word occupied, which will transfer them to the appropriate public entity. This is what they take from your house and keep it. Art objects, paintings, jewelry, valuable clothing, and food, we transfer to the Superior Council for reform. Therefore, be it ordered that these executed laws in all its parts, given the stay in the Presidential Palace, December 5th, 1961, Fidel Castro Ruz. His signature on that decree is signed. So when you visit Cuba, here's the scene. You're talking to an employee of a hotel or some business. They're not getting any of your money, and the building you're standing in, if it's a rented home, and that's the third item on the list that I'm going to be talking about. The rented house, or the house you're thinking of buying in Cuba, was what in 1961? Stolen. So if anything, we have a regime that traffics in stolen property. I think it's a felony in the state of Georgia. If you either transfer or sell or deal in stolen property, you go to jail for that. But yet, if you're a country with a flag and a national anthem, you have Obama making diplomatic openings to you. I still haven't been able to square that. So if you visit Cuba and you're standing inside of an older home, that home was stolen from its owners without restitution. Now, to add insult to injury, if you go to Google and you type in Cuba real estate, guess what you're going to see? Homes for sale. And I'm going to just zip through these. And I'd just like to say that it wasn't unusual. This is a scene very, very familiar to Cubans. Cubans used to arrive on airplanes like this, Pan American being the one that they remember the most. We remember it fondly, Pan American, because we escaped from on Pan American. My parents were on a Brandon flight, same difference, in 1961. And it wasn't unusual, just to let you know, Cubans did arrive and kiss the ground. Almost routinely. On television, in the newspapers, they always kissed the ground when they got here. Very happy to be in the United States. This is Javier Arzuaga giving last rites. This is the man who wrote the book about Che. And so when we talk about Che Guevara, we talk about the regime. We have the testimony of Javier Arzuaga. I strongly recommend that you seek out his book. Last rites. Last rites. I'd like to point out that he became a minister in the government. And what he shot here, and this is, actually, I'm going to interrupt myself and call this the third item, the fourth item. I'm going to skip ahead. Who did he just shoot? That is the police chief. The Castro regime is a band of cop killers. How many feel good about cop killers? Anybody? Well, here, let me turn down the first icon, which is Fidel. Let me just rip him from his medal and from his pedestal and throw him to the ground. Fidel started his criminal political career by shooting a police officer point blank and murdering him. That's how he began his career. And this is how it happened. Fidel Castro was running for student body president at the University of Havana. His nemesis, his opponent, was shot and killed. Fidel Castro was supposed to go to trial for murder. The only eyewitness was a young police officer, a young university police officer, who one day was playing on the steps with his daughter on his knee, and guess who walked up and shot him in the chest? Fidel Castro. Fidel Castro is a cop killer. Point blank range, shot him in the chest. How do we know this? Because you have Rafael Diaz-Balart. Rafael Diaz-Balart is the father of the two Diaz-Balarts that were in Congress. Some of you may be familiar that there are Cuban Americans in the US Congress, one of them being a Diaz-Balart. Rafael Diaz-Balart is the father of that man. Rafael Diaz-Balart gave testimony in the Senate in 1961 where he talks about that incident. That Fidel started his career by shooting a police officer in the chest and killing him. Now, when they took over the island, I just wanted to let you know that it was routine for the revolutionaries to dress in green fatigues. Sometimes they didn't dress in green fatigues, as you see, to go about the island killing sheriffs, police officers, and police chiefs routinely, tying their hands, putting them against a poster or wall and shooting them. Why would they get rid of the police?
Authority.
The police were the most closest protectors of the local population. That's why the Castro government targeted all of them and murdered them. So cop killers is the one I'd like to add. That's number four. Let me jump back to number three. Item number three. Parents' neighborhood. Let me just go on. That's the old neighborhood. That's the house that was taken. If you see what they're sitting inside of? That was taken by the Cuban government in the decree I read. Those are my parents. It's my mother, father, and my two brothers. So imagine you're sitting in Miami in 1961. You left all that behind. And you read it in the paper that the house that you took all these pictures in is gone. Taken by the government. And you have nothing but the clothes on your back in April of 1961 sitting huddling in Miami. This is the kind of life that they had, upper middle class, all handmade clothing, handmade shoes. That's a Google Earth photograph of the house. That's where we think it is. That's the view to the ocean. This road is called Quinta Avenida, Fifth Avenue, a very exclusive neighborhood. So I have been able to locate it. Back to item number three. If you type in Google, homes, or Google, Cuba homes for sale, for rent, you're presented with real estate websites where the Cuban government sells you or rents you houses. That they what? Stole from everybody in 1961. Have they paid anyone a dime for this? No, they've made no restitution. In fact, the Obama administration has been hearing Raul and Fidel say, what? You owe us money? We want you to pay us restitution? Well, what about the billions that they took from individual citizens and businesses in 1961? They haven't paid up for that. In fact, they're selling, dealing in stolen property on the international market. That's my parents' shop. Those are my brothers and my parents' shop. This shop was right up the road from their house. This shop was visited by guerrillas in a Jeep with a machine gun on the back, guns in the holster to basically extort my father out of the air conditioning, unit on the roof, very expensive one, because it was going to be given to a party official. They literally put a gun to his head to take it. Okay? And that business was confiscated along in the decree of 1961. Big difference. I'm going to show you how my mother used to dress. This is how they look like when they arrived in the U.S. You can see they're not real happy. They've had everything taken, and they're not combed. My mom has no makeup on. You can probably guess where I am. That's here in Miami. I can't believe they haven't valued it, but they had one. I'm in there somewhere. You can figure it out. And there I am. This is the house in Miami. We did not get public assistance. We got here legally. All the paperwork was handled with embassies and consulates. So we did have all our paperwork. I did go through the paperwork in November of this last year. I visited Miami. We found all the documents that my mother had amassed. It's about 60 documents from various ministries and at least 3 embassies and 2 consulates. So we did enter the United States legally. We got here with all the documents and we waited patiently for our green cards. They got their green cards. Of course, I was born here. And later they all became American citizens. every I was dotted and every T was crossed. And so this is in Miami. Probably figure out who I am. So while this is all going on, Castro's embracing Nikita Khrushchev. He's also talking to Ernest Hemingway. He's having a grand old time. A celebrity, by the way. You know the guy in the lower right is, right? He's having a cigar. People have been executed and murdered and their property confiscated, and he's having a cigar with Fidel. And there is Fidel having, I guess, lunch in Siberia with Nikita Khrushchev. And of course, Castro, of course, is a doll. In the lower right-hand corner, you see a picture of a medal being pinned to his chest by the late North Korean dictator. And of course, we see the other thug, which is Vladimir Putin, and you have the biggest thug of all, Z of China, who sent an armed shipment, by the way, to the FARC guerrilla. The FARC guerrillas in Colombia are still a holdover of the old communist guerrilla organizations. Narco-terrorists, half the world's cocaine is handled by the FARC. Who does the FARC in Colombia credit for their ability to have all this military prowess, all this military hardware, all this training that allows them to terrorize Colombia and various parts of Latin America? Who do they credit? Fidel Castro. Thank you, Fidel, for training, from turning us, what did they say, from a hit-and-run band into an organized army. That's the FARC. This is the Fidel Castro. This is the Fidel Castro that we lionize and consider a celebrity. This is someone going to be shot. Who is that? That's a picture you don't see on the front page of the New York Times. This is Raul Castro. And that's Fidel tying his hands behind his back. This is a hapless volunteer who they believed was not on their side completely, so they had him shot without trial. There he is lecturing, someone who is living in the countryside. And I just want to point out that he not always wore fatigues. Actually, he's playing gorilla, because that's how he really dressed. Fidel Castro was upper middle class, wealthy family, went to prep school, finest universities, was becoming a lawyer. He actually lived the life. He was a playboy, rabble rouser, fighter, brawler, just a ladies' man, and dressed very well. Designs on power, and he was considered part of the upper classes, which is why the richest classes, the upper classes of Cuba, actually financed his rise to power. Everybody thinks it was a bottom-up revolution. It was not. His demagoguery, his ability to persuade large crowds, definitely played a role, but all the money came from the wealthiest families of Cuba who wanted to replace Batista. So it was an internal coup by the power structure, the actual upper echelons of Cuban society, that replaced them. The reason I know that is my father was part of what knew all of those people in the upper echelons of Cuban society personally, and he was also friends with U.S. Ambassador Earl T. Smith. Now, Earl T. Smith wrote a book, which I highly recommend that you find. He is our U.S. ambassador. He was our U.S. ambassador to Cuba. It's called El Cuarto Piso. He spoke fluent Spanish. The book is called The Fourth Floor in English. If you want to know exactly how the Cuban Revolution went down, this is the only book that will tell you in detail how it went down chapter by chapter. I hope you find it. It's by Earl T. Smith, The Fourth Floor. And so he documents essentially what I heard my whole life. My dad told me everything about the Cuban Revolution, as did hundreds of other Cubans. I just want to let you know that what I'm sharing with you also comes from the verbal testimonies of people who floated over in rafts, who were dissidents, and who were defectors. I've spoken with people who have come up on rafts, who have crossed the Mexican border and have gotten to Miami any which way they possibly could. So I've actually heard the firsthand eyewitness testimony of what it's like to live there. And secondly, I've heard the stories from people who were politicians, who were judges, who were lawyers, who were doctors. I grew up around these people in Miami, and they all said the same thing. Everything I'm sharing with you is their testimony as well. And so there's Chet. Chet's favorite thing to do was to shoot people in the head.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. What do you think changed his image so that now people want to wear my shirt? Why do you think his image is changed like that?
Because they've concealed his real past. For example, Motorcycle Diaries. They made a movie called Motorcycle Diaries about Che Guevara. There are sections of the Motorcycle Diaries where he's very violent, and he calls for murder and death on Americans. That part didn't make it into the Motorcycle Diaries. Also, his personal letters to his father, his letters to various parts of the world, various individuals writing him, he basically confesses and outs himself. And in fact, there's one letter to his father that says, you know, Dad, basically I've learned that I really like killing people. He actually writes that to his father. And so I think what's happened is that the center left, the communists, the socialists, who dominate the media, don't want their icon sullied. They need him. They need him to be an icon to rally people around. And so they don't want that side of his history. There's a whole history of Che. I could do a whole presentation on Che. But Che was a psychopath. He enjoyed killing people. He relished it. Javier Arzuaga, the Catholic priest who gave his last rites, was with him for a whole year, day in and day out, and got to know the real psychopath. And that's not making it into the Hollywood movies. So this is what life was like in Cuba. Life was like in Cuba was, it was a hustling and bustling, very prosperous nation, one of the most economically advanced, socially advanced. Their 1940 constitution is progressive even by 2016 standards. If you read their constitution, which was a constitutional republic, in its structure, it's very progressive. A progressive today reading the English translation of the 1940 Constitution, think they're reading something that would have been written by a modern progressive. It was very progressive, very advanced, hardly oppressive, very center-left. So we had Sears, we had Woolworth, very much like the United States. Television, radio. And this is what it was like, for example, in the country clubs. People lived very well. They were very prosperous. They didn't steal anything. They worked very hard for their money. I'm not going to get bogged down on this side trip. There's my mom. I'm going to point that picture out because this is her probably in late 1930s, 1940s. And you see how they dress. I'm going to show some very contrasting photographs of how everything looks today. This is my mother. She was a singer, dancer, actress, very well known. Beautiful voice. That's her. Some of her publicity shots. That's my dad. And this is pictures on Varadero Beach. So just to let you know that when I hear about Varadero Beach, some people say, we're going to Varadero Beach for a vacation in Cuba. We're going to smoke a cigar. We're going to do this because we think Cuba's cool. Well, my parents, when they got engaged, were on Varadero Beach. So to me, it means something a little different. Okay, this is 1949, 1950. And that picture was taken. And this is probably the most beautiful picture of my mother. She's sitting on Varadero Beach. So when someone says, I'm going to go to Varadero Beach, I'm going to go enjoy Cuba because it's open now. Well, I just want you to know, to my family, it's a little more personal than that. A little more. As you can see from the photographs. This is Earl T. Smith. Earl T. Smith with his wife, with Batista, and with Kennedy. Most people don't know Kennedy had a back brace. He had a back problem. But there is Earl T. Smith with John F. Kennedy. Again, he was a good friend. You can see the before and after shots, the glamour shots of Cuba. Old Cuba's on the left. New Cuba's on the right. Progress, would you say?
Yeah.
A paradise. So you saw the picture of my mother, you saw the picture of the upper middle class young women, debutante balls, very well dressed, going out for the night. Well, there's only really two options for you. You can either make a queue, if you're a woman, and wait for food all day long, never get paid any real money, or you can be a jineteta. Cuba is one of the largest centers of sex trafficking in the world. Most young women have to basically sell themselves to tourists to make ends meet. Or you can be conscripted in the army and be part of the political and military army that the Castros are famous for. Just to let you know, most of them are of color. And during the 1970s, who was heard of Angola? The Castros were famous for renting out their army, their military, as mercenary armies for money, for cash, to communist governments in Africa. That was one of their main staples of earning hard foreign exchange, was to rent or pimp out the youth of Cuba, who, as you saw before, had a completely different life.
Angola.
Yeah, than the one they have now. As you can see, they do it to the men as well. Again, most of them are of color. And instead of a child growing up with dreams of becoming a singer or dancer like my mother in that photograph from the early 1930s, this is what you have to look forward to, being conscripted at an early age to be part of a political army belonging to one Fidel Castro and Raul Castro. So this is exactly what it's like to live there. That 20 pesos that you received, that you actually didn't get paid in hard currency, that's the line you make. There's lines everywhere, and you get that strip to buy whatever you can find. Okay, while the hotel is taking care of tourists, and why the Castros are pocketing the money. In 2006, this is the last estimate that was made of the Castro fortune, 2006, Forbes published a number, $1 billion is what Fidel Castro was worth. He was furious. Forbes never published it again. There was an incident, I think, 2 years ago, where, and this is also supplemented by a G2 defector, which is their version of the KGB, one of the bodyguards of Castro defected to the West. So I'm going to combine two sources into one. A story in Turkey broke where Alex Castro's bodyguards got into a scuffle with Turkish police. And while they were there, they noticed that he was there in the family's 167-foot yacht. The Castro dynasty, the Castro crime family, is worth billions, and they do have a 167-foot yacht that had just left the island of Mykonos towards Turkey, and Alex Castro was on it. They're millionaires, multi-millionaires, this family has. He has 8 children, and they've all gone to excellent schools. Some of them help run the government. So he's built a dynasty on the backs of murdered and robbed Cubans. So when I hear the stories about Castro, when I hear stories about Cuba, you're dealing with what? You're dealing with a company town surrounded by water that people have no escape from. A little hard to talk about. And so as I'm wrapping up and I'm thinking that I'm probably close to being out of time, and I certainly could cover more material, but this is the abbreviated version of the presentation. To add outrage to the situation, just to change the subject just for a moment. How many of you, obviously, it's a dumb question, we all remember 9/11? And we got burned in our memories, the towers blown up in front of our eyes. Well, October 3rd, 1962, Castro tried to do that to us a lot earlier than 9/11. Probably a story you never heard of. Allow me to read it to you. October 3rd, 1962, a few days before the onset of the Cuban Missile Crisis, Castro sent one of his trusted men to New York on a key mission. The man chosen for the job was Roberto Santebastian Casanova, who had just been appointed a minor post to the Cuban mission of the United Nations. His diplomatic passport identified him as an attaché to the Cuban mission. Santebastian's professional field, however, was not diplomacy. Quite the contrary, he was an expert terrorist. He was an expert in terrorist techniques, just graduated from the highly secret school of terrorism and subversion not far from Havana. As soon as Santebastian arrived in New York, he contacted the rest of the team, including Jose Gomez Abad and his wife Elsa, both attachés at the Cuban mission, and Jose Garcia Orellana, a Cuban immigrant who ran a costume jewelry shop in Manhattan. The Federal Bureau of Investigation, who caught them, estimates how many people were involved in the plot that I'm going to talk about, was from 25 to 50 people, 50 operatives. The secret mission that Castro had assigned them to this terrorist team, was to accomplish Castro's orders, ready, to blow up a big portion of Manhattan, including the Statue of Liberty, Macy's Department Store, several subway stations, the 42nd Street Bus Terminal, Grand Central Station, as well as several refineries along the New Jersey shore, including the Humble Oil Refining Company in Linden. To this effect, they stored a huge case of explosives at Garcia's shop. The FBI foiled an attempt to foist on us a 9/11 all the way back in October 3rd, 1962. How many of you knew that?
Didn't know that one.
That Castro had planned with over 500 pounds of TNT, was what they found, to blow up everything that I said. Had the FBI not intercepted them, would we have had a 9/11 before, back in 1962? Now, what makes it worse is the following. When the Soviet Union fell, the KGB archives blew open. At the same time he was doing this, he was calling Nikita Khrushchev. Trying to talk Nikita Khrushchev into this notion of the United States, there was an imminent attack from the United States on Cuba. Of course, we see the background, right? He was going to blow up something in the United States, and that the United States would attack. He was trying to trick Nikita Khrushchev into launching missiles against the United States. Fortunately, Khrushchev was not as crazy as Castro. Khrushchev, according to the Russian archives, says this man is out of his mind. Would you mind checking his story? They found that Castro had actually tried to dupe Nikita Khrushchev. He was not, wasn't real happy about that. But not only was he trying to force a 9/11 on us, he was trying to start a nuclear war. That's Fidel Castro. That's what we're dealing with. The cop killer who shoots a man point blank in the chest with his daughter on his knee. That's what we're dealing with. So I'm going to start winding this down because I could go longer. How do you feel that you know enough about Cuba now to understand that normalizing relations is wrong?
I've understood that from the get-go.
Okay. Medical care. This is the typical hospital for the typical Cuban. Everything's dirty, everything's on the floor, there is no medicine, there is no aspirin, there is nothing for anyone. That is for the typical Cuban. Operating salons are dirty and unsanitized, they've never been cleaned. If you want to get an x-ray, all the machines are broken. These are all taken undercover. This is the entrance to the operating room, it's never been opened, it is chained. Those are dental instruments in an actual, active, working dental office. Everything's dirty, there are no autoclaves, there is no alcohol, there is no running water, and there's no soap. So if you want something done with your mouth, they're going to use what's been shared with about 80 other people or 100 or whatever's been there for you. This is what's going on in Cuba. Now we understand why they're on racks. Not hard to understand why they're floating away. If it were a miracle, if the Castros were indeed miracle workers and Cuba was a paradise, we would not have tens of thousands of Cubans losing their lives since 1959. Actually, since 1967, when he shut the doors really tight, we wouldn't have had tens of thousands, if not over 100,000 Cubans floating across the Florida Straits to Miami, many of them never making it to Miami, dying of exposure, and dying because they're eaten by sharks. Now imagine you're fleeing Cuba on a raft, your raft doesn't make it, and it is typical, it is not unusual to have found rafts with dead people on them. That's why in the old days, remember in the 90s, there used to be patrols flown by Cubans looking for other Cubans on rafts. That's why they were doing that, because they were crossing the Florida Straits and they're shark infested. Just quickly, some resources, if some of your readers. A book called Against All Hope by Armando Valladares. He is the Cuban Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who wrote the Gulag Archipelago. Russia had its Gulag Archipelago. We had our Against All Hope, written by Armando Valladares. I highly recommend his book. He speaks before the United Nations and various international organizations. Antunes, 17 years in prison. He refers to himself as an Afro-Cuban, and he tells the story that Cuba it's wrong to put more money in the pockets of the Castros. What needs to happen in Cuba is regime change. This is a man who was in prison for 17 years. He also makes the case that Cuba is essentially a racist plantation economy because none of the leadership is black, number one. And if you are black, and I quote him, there's a 99% chance you're going to get the maximum penalty simply because you are black. And number three, all of the jails, according to him, are full of black people, Afro-Cubans. So it is a racist regime. So it is a throwback to the 18th century. So it's not only worse than being a plantation economy, it's not only worse than being a company town, it is an 18th century version of the company town. A throwback to the old colonial days when you had conquistadores, white Spanish conquistadors presiding over people of color. And so, as we wrap this up, I'm going to actually send a letter to your email. It was written by Miguel Quevedo. He actually wrote a letter that chillingly describes how the Communist Revolution duped him, duped everybody, and he actually tells you, play by play, what went wrong in Cuba. And it is a cautionary tale I hope that you'll all read, if you all can forward that email to the group, so you can read that letter and translate it into English. There's Javier Arzuaga. Owe him a debt of gratitude. He is the priest, I'm telling you, that gave last rites. That's his book, that's in 1985. Tells the truth about Che and the truth about the Cuban killing machine. The importance of Cuba. The madman that's in charge of Cuba controls an island. This is Cuba right here that controls all the choke points in and out up to the Gulf of Mexico. Most of our refineries and tonnage and all of our economy, 7 of our 10 largest ports are here. Castro sits here. There's one choke point he can easily squeeze. Here's another choke point he can easily squeeze. Can anybody guess what sits right here on the eastern tip? Guantanamo Bay.
Yeah,
now we know why we have Guantanamo Bay. We can't lose Guantanamo Bay because if he gets Guantanamo Bay, he pinches that shut and everything goes through what? Panama Canal. So if he's able to cause literally a blockage here and a blockage here, he basically didn't shut down the Gulf of Mexico and the Eastern Seaboard.
That's...
We'd be dead in the water.
That's why Obama wants that closed.
He wants to hand it back to them. Now, who's making very large investments in this entire area is Russia and China. China, through contract controls, the Panama Canal. Russia and China are building the Nicaragua Canal. And they're building military bases and allowing, and Venezuela in particular is allowing docking privileges for the Russian Navy. So essentially what's happening, if you're a military or a veteran, China and Russia are taking forward positions in the Western Hemisphere. Right. Two generals, Generals Kelly and Tovo, gave testimony before the Senate in 2014-2015, basically said, we are vulnerable in Southcom, the Southern Command. We've never been weaker. And the Russians and the Chinese are engaged in a buildup in the Western Hemisphere. They're taking forward positions. We're going to be caught by surprise. He didn't say that word, but he came very close to saying that to Congress. We're vulnerable and we're weak. This, also in military terms, is an aircraft carrier. A landmass that big functions as not only a staging area, it's also an aircraft carrier that could easily help take the United States. So I'm just saying, in military terms, there's more on the table here than just cigars and sandy beaches. Okay. So, Mom and Dad. Okay. That is the christening of my son, Alex. And I just want to say that I dedicate this to my mom. Mom was the one who got all the paperwork done. She is 92. And still kicking. That's taken in November. What I'd like to do is, as you think of questions that you'd like to ask me, I'd like to pass this album around. These are family photos. And so with that,
can you email
I open it for questions.
Can you send that email out?
Yes.
That map?
Yes, yes I can.
The whole presentation.
Yeah, I'm done, so thank you.
Sure,
thank you very much.
We'll post this on the website. We'll have a video, thanks to Nydia over there, who's videotaping. And, I admit it's something that I just didn't know about. I mean, I've heard the propaganda, I guess, if you want to use that word, that, you know, this is now, wow, we're getting ready. A friend of mine's a pilot, mm-hmm. and he said, we should go down there. I remain skeptical.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, they have an answer for the crime. I mean, every other dictator in the world is either dead or has stood trial, like Slobodan Milosevic or the crimes against humanity stood trial. The original dictator of North Korea has died, has passed. Stalin's dead, Lenin's dead, Hitler's dead. They're all dead except for one, Fidel.
Obama.
Yeah. All right. So Fidel is the icon to Cubans. He's our Hitler who's still alive. He's our Stalin who is still alive. And so it hurts when we see the world embracing him and wanting to do business with him.
How old are his kids, do you know?
His kids are in their 40s. Yeah, in their 40s, yeah. And they're very well educated. Like I said, they've attended the best schools.
They active?
They are very active. In fact, the G2, which is their KGB defector in the United States, blew the lid off the fact that they have their own private island off the coast of Cuba. With multiple homes and multiple compounds. They live very, very, you know, lifestyles of rich and famous off the coast of Cuba as billionaires.
When I talk to people that have been there and hit them, they're going to say, well, I tipped the people. So when the people are serving them and they're tipped,
they have to give that money out.
Okay, how do they know?
Well, because there's an army of snitches. And I do want to add that the family unit is completely destroyed in Cuba because your family turns you in. Your uncles, your nieces, your nephews, your mother, your father, your sister, your kids turn you in. And if your kids turn you in, your coworkers are going to turn you in.
Okay.
And you're being watched at all times by a network of snitches informally. Also, the criminal network, which is tied to the government, is watching you.
Yep.
And so what they do is they do the old shakedown. They know you've got dollars, they know you've got euros, and they're going to want their percent, and they're going to take almost all of it.
Okay.
And
it's kind of like you couldn't spend it anyway.
Again,
they kept the money.
I think what they do is they use the money on the black market to get things that are very difficult to find, that they can't get with convertible pesos out of the company stores. So there is a black market that answers to a euro, that answers to a dollar, but it's all very, very hush hush.
Is there any private ownership of land? I mean, do normal people own normal property at all?
No. Everything's on a string. For example, in Cuba, if you're a foreign business concern, and I did leave out one thing, which I'll cover quickly. If you're a foreign investor, you don't own the property the hotel's on. You don't even own the hotel. The kind of contracts that Cuban government signs with you is a management contract. You're allowed to manage the property. 51% ownership, I think, is the minimum that the Castro government requires. The other 49% is a foreign concern. And I do want to say one last thing, just the final outrage. A law was passed about a year before, about a few months before normalization. It was Law 188. 188 basically said the following, and it's outrageous to hear. If you're Cuban born, if you're born on the island of Cuba as a Cuban citizen, you are specifically excluded from being an investor in your own island. Let me run that by you again. So if you're a German or Italian or an Australian coming with money to invest in Cuba, if you're a Cuban citizen who's managed to scrape together a few stray bucks, you're specifically excluded, prohibited from being an investor in your own, in the nation of your birth. And when they asked the head of the assembly, the Cuban assembly, why that was, it's because they are not making any changes to the socialist system. They'll take foreign investors' money, but they're not going to change who they are. They're not going to change how they do things. They're not going to change the darn thing. By the way, if you're a Cuban citizen, you are specifically excluded, in addition to being paid in script, in addition to having had everything stolen and nothing belonging to you, in addition to having an army of snitches, in addition to having the kind of medical care, and you wanted to flee off the island in a rickety raft, on top of everything, you can't be an investor in your own country. You're not allowed to.
All right, thank you very much. The importance of law enforcement being on our side is cannot be, what a great segue. We have Ron Freeman came. Yes, Trilby?
We have coffee and we have water back here. If anybody would like, we got some water.
Okay, great.
So if you raise your hand, I'll throw in some water.
Ron Freeman came to one of our meetings a while ago, and I didn't even know he was running for sheriff. We started talking about police stuff, and I learned over the last couple of years what a sheriff is. The difference between it's like judges. I always thought sheriff, police officer, you know, and I thought they're all the same. So I asked him if he would come tonight a little bit. He is running for sheriff in Forsyth County, coincidentally, but he also has been in law enforcement for 30 years or something like that.
Yeah.
A graduate from the FBI Academy. So he knows what he's doing. So I thought had a few questions I thought I'd throw out at him.
Sure.
He wouldn't mind talking about it for a little bit and answering questions. So go ahead. You want a microphone or you?
If everybody can hear me, I can talk pretty loud. I'm used to being in front of crowds. I'm actually a college professor as well, so means I can stand up here for about 8 hours, but I'm not going to do that to you. Can everybody hear me okay? Want to speak? All right. So when we met and we were talking, I said, all right, so here's the question. I love to do interactive things. I told you I actually teach. I've been teaching for years, both in law enforcement profession and with college. So I love when I get questions back, and it's kind of a two-way conversation. So can anybody tell me what you believe the difference is between a police chief, which I've been a deputy police chief, okay, from Brookhaven, and a sheriff is? What's the difference? Sheriff is elected. The number one difference, you're exactly right. Sheriff is elected, but what are the, they're still executives of law enforcement agencies, all right?
Acting elector.
Sheriff in Georgia has a weird relationship to the tax commissioner, where the tax commissioner actually carries a title of a quasi-sheriff in some terms. I'm using some different terms, but as a quasi-sheriff to give them the authority to collect taxes under the Georgia Constitution. A sheriff is elected, but a sheriff is a constitutional officer, which means they don't answer to the county. They don't answer to the county board of commissioners. And we're going to particularly talk about Georgia sheriffs, the Georgia Constitution as it exists, and what some of those differences may be. All right. So a sheriff is elected. It's elected for a four-year term. It's elected strictly by the voters. In Georgia, it's not a nonpartisan. It is a partisan election. You declare your Democrat, your Republican, independent, what the case may be. So from that standpoint, when it's elected as a constitutional officer, the only say-so, if you will, that the Board of Commissioners has to the sheriff of the county, and there's 159 counties in Georgia, and constitutionally each county must have their own sheriff. The only say-so is they set the budget of the sheriff. Constitutionally and by law, they often have to set a budget that allows the sheriff to fulfill their needed duties. You see some potential conflict here? Okay. Well, it can go either way. So you may have a board of commissioners who doesn't want to fund a sheriff's office adequately, or you may have a sheriff who wants way too much of our tax dollars. Right? So it often has ended up in the state of Georgia and in other states, because in almost every state in our nation, the sheriff is elected. All right? It has often ended up into a legal battle. You, Ms. Commissioner, must fund, I'm asking for $40 million. You went, wow, $40 million is our entire tax base. from residential property. That's too much. Can't you cut back? Can't you do 36 million? I say I can't do my job with 36 million, and then we end up in a legal battle. So it is a unique situation that we find ourselves in a constitutional office. Yes, sir.
But you are conservative, liberal, and I've got to follow up.
Yes. All right, so I started off, and let me just tell you real quick with my background. Again, my name's Ron Freeman. I had 26 years with the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office. The last 2 years, I was the Deputy Chief of Police in Brookhaven, which is a brand new city, a newly incorporated city. I got to help build that police department, along with a lot of good men and women. I have lived in Forsyth County for going on almost 40 years. My wife's family's only been here a day or two since the 1820s. I'm married well. Okay. Do I call myself a Republican or Democrat? No, I call myself a constitutionalist. I'm very much a constructionist.
Okay, I can accept that.
I have a very distinct belief in the Constitution. I know that the folks that wrote our Constitution were a whole lot smarter than me, and I know that what they had in mind, and I don't think it was meant to be bent, because we're now in 2016 versus when it was written.
The follow-up question is, Homeland Security is going around the country confiscating stuff that sheriff's departments were given across this nation because, to some degree, those sheriffs will not play ball. In other words, they are not willing to, if the need arises, go against their own people.
Well, if you're talking about the Defense Department plan, which is a sharing plan for the Defense Department, it's where local law enforcement agencies, it wasn't just sheriffs, it was sheriffs or police department,
right,
had the ability to request surplus military products. Now, in some cases, we've seen where some of those surplus military products, I'll be honest, seemed a little silly to me. In some agencies, you know, when we got 450 bayonets for a 100-person police department, I can't reconcile that in my head.
Right.
All right. But I will tell you, here in Forsyth County years back, I was able to acquire about, and I'm going to make up a number, but it was somewhere in the neighborhood of about 60 ballistic helmets, Kevlar ballistic helmets like our soldiers wear. Do we want our police force wearing ballistic helmets every day out here when we're serving the public? Probably not. But in your trunk, when someone inside a house is shooting bullets at you, I like the idea of having a helmet on my head.
I have been
shot at before, and it makes a distinctive sound, and it's not the, you know, unlike some other people, I actually have been shot at. Somebody got that one. All right, I wasn't understanding. But it made sense because it would have cost me your money as a taxpayer, almost $400 a helmet to do it, and I pay shipping charges to get these surplus helmets for our deputy sheriffs here. Now, what's happened, as you know, there's been an executive order that came down, and it's required a lot of those things to be returned. Things like armored vehicles, certain types of weapons, bayonets, now certain other things like fatigues and boots and other things that agencies have been able to get, they weren't required to return those. I don't know if it was such a case of playing ball as much as it was a case of extreme left saying we don't want militarization of our police. Guys, I was a SWAT commander, SWAT officer for almost 20 years. Very seldom did I put on all my SWAT stuff, right? When did I do it? When somebody was inside of a house or somebody was shooting at someone. I probably had my SWAT stuff on culminated my 29-year career for probably a solid week. If you added all the, you know, 7 24-hour days. So it wasn't like the militarization of the police is maybe as quiet as we've seen, maybe as quite as well portrayed as we've seen. So from that standpoint, do I like that? No, but I also don't believe that our police should be militarized. But they should have the equipment to protect themselves and protect you.
Those are
just a common sense application of where it is. Going back to the sheriff's office, a sheriff is elected. This sounds crazy. Who knows the history of where sheriffs came from? Wow, y'all know it. Awesome. So, really fast, comes from Old England, comes from shires, who basically ran counties, to put it in our common terms, and then they appointed reeves, who were basically the overseers of it. They took care of the problems. They enforced certain rules. They enforced what the king wanted the shire to do. Fast forward a long time forward, Shire, Reeve, language changes, we come up with sheriffs. Sheriffs in England, of course, where the predominance of our influx in the East Coast come from, that came from England, and so now we have sheriffs in the United States. And of course, it has become, and it is indeed, the legitimate and the most prominent law enforcement figurehead that we know in the United States, right? All the way back to the Old West, all the way back to anything else. And in Georgia, the sheriff is the chief law enforcement officer of the county. So go back to the difference between a police chief and a police sheriff. I'm sorry, a sheriff and a police chief. The other difference is a police chief, when I was a deputy police chief, I had a city manager that I reported to. And even though it was a city manager, form of government, I had all these city council people who wanted to tell me we need to do this and this and this. And so I actually answered to a city manager, correct? So a sheriff answers to the people, all right? Does that mean that there shouldn't be a working relationship between other county officials? No, there's only a few county officers in the state of Georgia, which are constitutionally elected officers that are mentioned in the Constitution. Anybody know what the other ones are? Outside of the sheriff?
Registered.
Tax commissioner?
Registered.
Clerk of the court?
No.
Judge?
No.
DA.
So, we run across, there's only a few listed positions. I'll give you those in just a second. But it's funny because we think the DA, we think this and those kind of things, and it's actually not. All right, probate judge is one of them. Superior court judge is not. Probate judge is. Although they are elected officers and they carry some of the same things. So when we come back to the difference between, that always comes back to the question, what's the difference between a deputy sheriff and a police officer? Anybody ever thought about that?
Is it jurisdiction? Is there any jurisdiction?
Somewhat. There is a little bit of jurisdiction. How many think that a police officer from, let's use a city of Cumming because we're talking about Forsyth County. How many thinks that a city of Cumming police officer could write you a ticket in Dawsonville on Georgia 400?
Yes.
Show me by hands if you don't mind.
I say yes.
He's the guy that's right in the room. There's actually an exception in Georgia law that says for a moving motor vehicle violation, any police officer who sees that, it witnesses it, sees it in action, can actually stop and write that citation. Now, it has to be prosecuted through Dawson County courts, okay? But a municipal police officer, now, the specific exception is moving vehicle violations. I see you shoplift something, if I can pick on you for a minute, at Dawsonville Outlet Mall, because we mentioned Dawsonville. Most of us probably know where that's at, correct? I am a city of Cumming police officer. Can he arrest you for seeing you shoplift that? As a Cumming police officer, can he arrest you?
Does it make a difference if he's on duty or off duty?
Really doesn't. If he's a peace officer, he's a peace officer.
I still say he can.
Okay. As a citizen, he can make a citizen's arrest. But his jurisdiction ends at his municipalities, unless he's had some other granting of power. All right. So the exception is just removing vehicle violations, traffic violations. But a municipal police officer has certain jurisdictional limits. Can they serve a warrant that's been signed by a judge outside of their city limits? Actually, they can. It says to all peace officers. So there's a lot of separation. You've got to understand, peace officers have to understand there's a difference. All peace officers in the state of Georgia can serve an arrest warrant, a subpoena, those kinds. But the sheriff himself and his agency are required by the Constitution to serve all writs, warrants, papers, to secure the courts, okay? To be the chief jailer and provide both custody and care for prisoners. Those are constitutional requirements of the office of sheriff. Police chiefs don't have those constitutional requirements. Matter of fact, when I was a deputy chief in Brookhaven, I didn't have a jail at the police department. We used the DeKalb County Sheriff's Office jail. And it was his responsibility to offer care and custody of those people. Okay. What other differences has anybody ever wondered about? I have my little cheat sheet that I take notes of to see where we're at. Any other questions? Because I've got something else I'm going to take into. Anybody ever wondered the difference between something else you want to know about the office of sheriff or what a sheriff does?
I wanted to ask if the sheriff's budget, where it comes from, and if any of it comes from the
Okay. Sheriff's budget itself comes from the county commission, which is from the taxpayers. The budget comes from that. There are opportunities and there are times at which federal monies come into a sheriff's office, generally not in the budgeting process. There are federal grants, and actually when you look at a lot of what we consider state grants, they're backfunded by federal grants. Okay? You will also find that in some places, you can apply directly for a federal grant. So we've ever heard of COPS grants, community-oriented policing, back in the 80s and early 90s, that was a big federal grant, and those grants came. So maybe they funded excess to the budget. When I say excess monies that were not included in the original budget. But federal monies are not included in the budget per se. It comes from the county revenue sources, which is your taxes, which is commercial taxes, licensing fees, franchise fees, if it's a city, something like that. But no, it doesn't come directly from the federal government.
So you wouldn't consider that the federal government had any kind of leverage on the sheriff's office?
Actually, the only place that the federal government has some leverage on the sheriff's office is in equitable sharing, where they set rules on how drug seizure monies can be spent. Well, that's equitable sharing, it's asset forfeiture. Because the formal name is equitable sharing, it's asset forfeiture.
It's theft.
So those monies have limitations on by the federal government on what you can use those if you accept those monies. Yes, sir.
There's a delicate question. And there's been incidents around the country for years. Federal agent, let's say, this is a hypothetical.
Sure.
You, a sheriff, constitutionally elected sheriff like yourself, witnesses a federal agent doing something that you know is contrary to Georgia law. What authority do you have over that federal agent?
If he's doing something contrary to Georgia law, you have the same authority over him as you do any citizen in the state of Georgia. Now, when we're talking about contrary to state law, if he or she is violating the state law, you would do the same as one of my own police officers, one of my own deputy sheriffs violating state law. There actually is no difference. You have no shield because you were a federal officer.
So if he has a federal regulation or federal law that he's enforcing, that he claims that he's enforcing, so it's contrary to Georgia law, what do you do?
So here's the question that comes up. So I'll give you that. Everybody always wants to understand. Everybody will shake their head when I do this. Everybody's going to give me one of these, I can tell. What if there's a state of emergency declared by the federal government and some kind of confiscation of firearms is ordered?
Okay.
Everybody's kind of going with your thought on something like this. Georgia has laws on the book right now, and I teach a lot. I'm a firearms instructor. I've been for many, many years, and I teach a lot on firearms laws, and I'm pretty well versed in Georgia firearms laws. There are a couple laws on the book, paraphrase them. One says that no database can be kept of who has Georgia weapons license, those kind of things. There is no database that can be kept under Georgia law, except by the local probate judge. So there is no database for the feds to come in and snatch away if that was a thought process that that could happen. It doesn't exist because Georgia law says it can't be held, okay, by any Georgia entity. Second thing is there's a Georgia law that's on the books right now that says during a state of emergency, ammunition or weapons shall not be confiscated, nor shall the right of citizens to bear arms be infringed on. Not only is that a constitutional, okay, in paragraph 8 of our Bill of Rights of the Georgia Constitution, it does qualify, separate from the Constitution of the United States Second Amendment, that the state legislature or the governing body of the state of Georgia does have the right to define how you bear arms. That's why we have Georgia weapons license, right? So if you're gonna carry a gun in certain places right now, you have to have a license to do that, right? In the state of Georgia. But there is a state law on the books, and it's relatively recent, that says that cannot be. So for anyone doing that, they're violating state law. And I think that's your answer, is no.
So door-to-door confiscation, like they did for Shannon, would not be
permissible. It is absolutely not permitted by Georgia law. There is a specific law that says that cannot happen in the state of Georgia.
So it's theft, right? If they're trying to take it, it's theft?
Oh, it's a violation of that law itself. Plus, if somebody takes your gun, you're right. They have no right under Georgia law, even in a state of emergency, to take it. It would be theft. You could argue that it is a theft. Okay. So everybody wants to know, when I have private conversations, hey, Ron, you're running for sheriff, what would you do if? Well, the simple answer that I gave, and I think some of the first answer is, I have a lot of guns. I'm a competitive shooter. I've had a lot, you know, sounds funny, I have a lot of guns, but I am. I'm a competitive shooter. I've shot for a long time. I was a SWAT officer for a long time. So if they can take yours, they can come take mine first.
Right.
Because that's the answer. You can't. Georgia law says you can't do it. You're violating the Georgia Constitution and I'll be violating my own oath of office if I allow it to happen. Did you have a question, ma'am?
No.
I'm sorry.
Okay. All this stuff. What do you do with the stuff all year that you get confiscated from people?
So things that are confiscated, there's two ways things can be confiscated, actually three ways things can be confiscated. One is they're contraband themselves, right? So let's say we confiscate brass knuckles from a miner because they're contraband, they can't have those. Those things won't be sold out anywhere, if they want anything to be done, they're actually destroyed, something like that. The second thing we can confiscate is under a state asset forfeiture plan, you can actually confiscate cars, money, other items of interest, if you can connect those to criminal activity. Okay, so it's allowable under a plan, it can be done. Third way is federal asset.
Prior to conviction or?
I'm sorry?
Prior to conviction or?
Right now it can be prior to conviction, particularly on federal. However, there's a lot of changes in the law right now that are being discussed. There's a lot of things that are being discussed about asset forfeiture. And in fact, if you don't know, right now the equitable asset plan, which is the federal drug seizure asset forfeiture plan, has been suspended. Right now, any monies that are being taken under federal asset forfeiture are not being sent back to the states or counties or local municipalities.
So the feds stealing it all?
Well, the question is whether the question becomes is whether they're going to take it. I was at a meeting with the Department of Justice and some FBI officials in January, and their answer was it was a budgetary reason because of sequestration that's how they couldn't afford to run the program anymore. That was the answer that we were given as law enforcement executives from the Department of Justice. I was in the meeting. All I can tell you is that was the answer that I was given. And they did indicate that they thought it would at some point start back up. But that is an issue for Congress to pass, and it's an issue for the Department of Justice to pass. So the three ways you can do it. So what do we do with those things? Obviously, if it is a legal seizure, let's pick on someone, and my wife's back here. I can't pick on her. I'll keep a bad dribble. No, I won't do that. So if I can pick on you, can I pick on you for a minute? All right, so Roy's been involved in chopping cars and stealing cars for 20 years, and he's a meticulous record keeper of it. And we finally catch the bad guy, Roy, who's been stealing cars for 20 years. And we have records of every car that he stole, every car that he changed, every car that he sold, and how much money he got for the stolen car. And he's got it in a safe in his house. Okay, outside of restitution, that is their ill-gotten gains, and that money could be seized. What would we do with that? Portions of it must go back to the district attorney if it's involved in a state seizure. The other portions can be spent for law enforcement purposes. Those are the things that can happen with asset forfeiture funds. Can't be used to supplant the budget, so if you seize $1 million, it can't come back, and the commissioner's taking $1 million out of the budget, but it can be used for law enforcement purposes. The last thing that I'll just throw at you when we do this is, everybody always wants to know, and I want to know what you think. What do you think the biggest problem we have in Forsyth County is when it comes to our community and law enforcement, when it comes to criminal justice, when it comes to crime? What is the biggest problem that you think we have?
Drugs.
Everywhere I go, everywhere I talk, this is what I hear. How many of you think we have a drug problem in our schools?
Oh, absolutely not.
We're just finishing up a survey right now where we actually had high school students survey high school students. Because I want them to know for real. Because otherwise we're not getting the real information. We do a drug survey in the school. Anybody have kids in the school or grandkids in the school? And they tell you every year they do an online drug survey. But we tell them to log in with their username and password and it's an anonymous survey. Right?
Yeah.
So we asked them, how can you tell us the truth about that? And you know what the results, the preliminary results are? Not very often to tell the truth. So we asked them to tell us about your friends. If I ask you to tell me about if you cheated on your taxes or not, hypothetically, you probably not going to tell me. If you tell me if you knew someone else that was a friend of yours that told you that did it, you might do it if you don't have to identify that friend. So we went statistically and looked at what's going on there. And I will tell you that it's scary. I will tell you that it is frightening. I will tell you that the numbers will blow your mind. And I'll tell you that it is not a law enforcement problem that can solve it. It is not a law enforcement issue. It is a law enforcement issue. Law enforcement can't solve it. It is a village problem, if you know what I mean. It's going to take our community, our churches, law enforcement, accountability courts, our schools, and number one, parents, to do it. And we've got to get in this and quit. We all say there's a problem, and then I talk to moms, and you know what they tell me? Well, they all know who the kids, my kids all know who's selling drugs. Or I know which parents allow them to come in the house and go in the basement and do this and this and this. But I'm not going to say anything. But how many of you heard something like this or know something like this? I guess a bunch of heads doing this. We've got to quit ignoring the 800-pound gorilla in the room. And we have got to do something about it, or we're going to lose more kids. And that's something I'm not willing to do. I can't tell you how many parents I have talked to that asked me to come speak to their kids because they got caught with drugs at home, because they got caught with something else. I do this, and what they tell me, if I can get them to be honest, because I'm not there to scare them and shake my finger at them. I'm there because I care about them. And if I can get them to break down and be honest with me, what they're telling me in school is scaring me. My old son, a 17-year-old at a local high school, came home the other day, and they've got a new football coach. He's a football player, and I was all excited. He said, "Guess what I learned in the weight room today, Dad?" I was like, "Cool, what'd you learn?" You know? I'm a football coach. I'm a youth football coach. What'd you learn? I learned if you're going to get high on marijuana brownies, you got to eat a lot and you got to eat them really fast. Otherwise, it's just not the same kind of high. He said, "That's what about 15 of the guys were discussing in the locker room today." That is not what I want to hear that he learned in weightlifting today. Now, does that mean everybody on his football team is doing something bad? No. No, I'm not implying that. But I'm implying that we've got to do more than we're doing. Drug summits are great. It's great that we put 300 parents in it. How many students do we have in Forsyth County schools? Anybody have an idea? Somewhere around 40K, 40,000. How many parents do we have? So great, we got education in 300 of them. We're missing a few? Just one or two?
The ones you're missing, if all the ones whose children have a problem.
We've got to get in there and we've got to force this issue. And we've got to get the school board to look at this issue. We've got to get law enforcement to look at this issue. And we've got to have a course to hold kids accountable. I don't believe we need to make every kid gets caught with something a criminal. But we need to make them think twice about doing it again. And make it painful enough in some way with education that they're not going to reoffend. Okay? It's education. It's compliance. It's accountability. And it's parents.
Are locker checks against privacy law?
No, locker checks are not against privacy law in schools. You can actually run a drug dog through schools, but here's what the kids are telling us. They're not seeing a ton of dope in the school before and after school, and on weekends in people's basements, and mom and dad says it's okay. As long as y'all don't leave, you can drink in here, but I don't know about the pills they're doing. That's what we're seeing.
Sorry. You think some of the draconian consequences of kids engaging in this sort of activity, and I mean by that not only criminal consequences but subsequent employment consequences, are impeding cooperation by parents? I mean, to me, it's to take a 17-18-year-old kid and basically give them an impediment for life in getting future employment. What you've got is a public health problem. It's being dealt with as a criminal justice problem.
An addiction problem is exactly what you just said. It is a public health issue. It is a mental health issue. It is an addiction problem. That's why I just said what I said. I do not believe that we need to criminalize our way through kids. I think we have to hold them accountable. I think we have to put them in pretrial diversion programs. I think we have to put them in education. I think we got to make them pick up trash on the side of the road. We got to make them think about doing it again. But we don't need to ruin their lives for it.
Well, is there any thought in giving the expunging all these records after they turn 21?
Again, that is one that has to be worked with in the criminal justice system, in the judicial system, and that's something that we have to do in accountability courts. And in some cases in accountability courts, we're seeing that right now. We're seeing it as a first offender. But you know what? It doesn't always have to go through the criminal justice system. It doesn't always have to be an official, you're charged with, and now you must do this. You tell us your kid is involved in this, we find out, let's get them in the program. And even more importantly, let's get to them before we catch them doing something so that we don't have to put your kid in a program. That's what we got to do.
Unfortunately,
I'm sorry.
Ron Freeman?
Thank you. Thank you very much, guys.
I personally talk to parents who I know have bad kids, and they'll say, "Oh, All right, we'll be up here. If you have any questions, you come talk to us. Thanks for both of our speakers coming out and for all of you coming out tonight.
Thank you for what you gave all the
Guess what?
Also,
and the
Hey, sir.